Hello and welcome to the Practice Parlour. I am Gina Morgano and I am here today with my friend Matthew Carey. And Matthew is actually in Australia. So this is a conversation that's taking place over continents, which is pretty cool. Matthew is the podcast host of Studio Time. His blog is The Infinite Creative, and he is also a musician, a pianist, and a music director. He is an artist himself, but he's a champion of artists. He connects creatives with the training and tools that make it easier for them to do their best work. So, Matthew, welcome to the Practice Parlour. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you, Gina. It's a pleasure to be here. I wish I had you to introduce me everywhere I showed up.
So I would love to learn more of your story. I first was introduced to your work through your podcast before we met in the Big Ideas Lab in, well, I was going to say in person, but over Zoom. And I know that you are also an artist, so I would love to hear your journey.
Great. That feels like I'm 46 now, so it feels like a very long story. So I'll try and give you the condensed version of it. And I do think that Zoom is almost the new in person. So so here we are. We're having this conversation basically in person. I started playing the piano when I was 5 or 6. My mom and dad asked me if I wanted to take lessons. They didn't have a musical background, but they were really supportive in me doing artistic things. So I studied music and even some dancing growing up, although you wouldn't know that so much looking at me these days. I'm not as flexible and certainly not as slender as I was once upon a time. But the music stuck, and it was something that I did and I enjoyed. And I guess I had some, maybe some natural facility at it, but it was something that I was able to do and enjoy and get some acknowledgement and encouragement with. And so, you know, I think for a lot of us, that sort of early acknowledgement that we've maybe got some skills that make other people, like that impress or make other people happy, gives us the impetus we need to do the work. So I just kept playing and kept practicing. I really focused on keyboard instruments. I was fortunate enough to study, well, to show you how old I am, I studied on the electronic organ back when I was starting out before moving to the piano for real. I'm not quite this old, but I did study harpsichord for a while I was at school. It was already kind of retro back then. And then, I mean, I've also frustrated a couple of viola teachers and anybody who had to sit next to me in the school orchestra, but piano was really where it was at. And I think one of the things that set me apart from the other piano players I knew was that I loved accompanying. I was lucky that I had pretty good sight reading skills, which I think is something that I hear is common in people that sort of go on to being musical directors. So the idea that I could sight read meant that I could pick up a piece of music and play music with friends. And the thing I realized later on as a piano teacher is that being a piano player can be a bit solitary because you're often practicing on your own. You don't necessarily get to play in the ensembles as often as some of the other instrumentalists. But as an accompanist, I was able to make music with other people regularly. That was something that I sort of put in my backpack and took with me when I went to university here and studied jazz piano. Jazz piano was the best fit for me at the time. I know that you had an episode of a while back with Ian, who was also a musical director. And one of the things he talked about was that he didn't really know that you could study musical direction when he was at university or studying. And I certainly didn't know that was the thing either. In fact, I didn't really know you could study music theater, and you couldn't do it properly in the city where I was in. So jazz piano seemed like the best fit for me, although I would never really call myself a jazz pianist. My membership isn't current with the jazz police. But it was a great way for me to keep playing lots of different styles of music, which was something that I enjoyed. And the same time I was doing that studying, I would go across to the classical conservatorium across campus and play for accompany singing lessons from the classical singers and the opera students there. So I was able to keep doing my accompanying and earn a little bit of pocket money and keep my musical spectrum kind of broad. Then I started doing, once I graduated, I wasn't really interested in going full on into the jazz world. So I looked for somewhere that I could keep accompanying. And the first way was working with a singer, and we did a whole bunch of piano bar sort of work. This guy was a little bit older than what I was, and he sang, and he had a bunch of gigs. And gigs were what I was looking for at that point in time. And so I joined up with him, and we started doing just regular piano bar gigs, doing just your typical sort of covers and piano bar repertoire. And then as time progressed, I think we both thought we'd like to do something that felt a little bit more interesting, a little bit more challenging for us. And so we started putting together, I guess, themed sets, we'd call them, that we sort of called them shows. We had like this Broadway show, and then we had a Sinatra show, which made us a little bit different to the other acts that were playing around town. And we managed to do some touring, and we were just doing this off our own back. And then at some point I discovered the word cabaret and the world of cabaret. And it wasn't something that I'd been introduced to before, except, I mean, maybe I'd seen the film, but I had never made the connection. And I was fascinated by it. I've got to admit, I am, always will be a Barbara Streisand fan. And it was partly through learning about her, the early part of her career, where she'd play in these cabaret rooms in the village in New York. And I just thought it was fascinating, and I wanted to learn more about it. So I'd read about it. I found some recordings from the early part of her career, and I thought, you know, this is like the fancy version of what we've been trying to do. What if we tried to create some cabaret? So my mate David and I, we moved from like doing our piano bar shows into shows we called cabaret shows. And we were kind of finding our own way through this. Really, there was nowhere much to learn about cabaret until it just so happened that there was another man who lived in the same city as we did, who was also interested in the idea of cabaret. And he suggested to the powers that be in the government, actually, that they set up this cabaret festival in Adelaide, which is my hometown. This cabaret festival became the biggest cabaret festival. Well, I mean, there's not that many of them, but it became the biggest cabaret festival in the world within a few years. And so all of a sudden, anyone that was doing cabaret in Australia would come through this festival, and then we'd have international artists as well. We'd have people from New York, we'd have people from Europe. It was a real melting pot of cabaret. And I learned so much by being in the middle of all that. It really, I just love soaking up anything I can learn from other artists. And here were people that had like more direct connections, I guess, to that world that I was really interested in. Because I had developed some skills as a musical director, I would play for local acts, and then I would sometimes get booked for playing for some of the international acts. So I got to make some connections there. And cabaret really became my thing then for, I guess, 10 years or so. And so then I guess the other part of my life starts to feed into this is that, you know, as an accompanist, as a musical director, you're always trying to help people build better shows, make their shows as good as possible, make their art as good as possible. And what I was discovering is that we were making some really good shows, but the artists I was working with were not really doing great business. I was trying to think about this morning. Michael Feinstein is the only guy I know who's ever made a fortune from cabaret. But, you know, even on cabaret scales, you know, these shows weren't doing that well. And so I started looking at that, and I thought, well, this business model is currently flawed. You know, we've got people that have been working for a long time. They bring a lot of skill to their creative discipline, but they're not finding a way to make a career that sustains them out of this. And so that was something that was in the back of my mind, because it was a challenge for me as well. I was doing lots of work, but I was never really making a great living out of it. Then somewhere along that way, I discovered a couple of books that changed my life. The two or three that sort of stand out were The 4-Hour Workweek, that was written by Tim Ferriss. Tim had this way of like introducing me to the idea. I mean, I'd heard of work smarter, not harder, but he sort of showed how you could do that. And he introduced me to this idea that was actually originated by another guy called Kevin Kelly called 1000 True Fans, which changed my perspective on everything. And at the same time, I discovered a couple of books by Seth Godin, Lynchpin and The Purple Cow. So Seth has this approach to marketing that really resonated with me. Seth's had an amazingly successful career, but his approach to marketing has always been heart-centered rather than money-focused. And coming from my background as an artist, that felt like the right way to be. Sometimes talking about money as a creative, as an artist, feels a bit crass, which is weird because we need it as much as anybody. But, you know, we're not taught, I wasn't taught to think like that. But these ideas started percolating and I started trying to put them together in a way that how could I use these ideas? How could I share them with the other creative people that I really cared about so that we could build careers that sustain us? Then this story is coming to a close soon, I promise. Then I started getting into doing more theater. So I started touring with musicals around Australia. And I thought that when you were an artist that had a salary and you were kind of working full time, it would be different. And to an extent, it was and is. But then I started realizing that in a cabaret show, you're playing to maybe 50 or 100 people a night, and you've got a chance to build a small following there. But then when I realized in a commercial theater show, you're playing to, you know, thousands of people every week. And I looked, by this point, I was kind of looking at the businesses around me and trying to learn what are they doing differently that's making them more successful, at least in financial terms, than us as artists. And I thought the businesses of the business, like the producers, the theater owners, the ticket masters or the ticket sellers, with every performance, they're building a database of people that love to see this sort of work. And so next time they've got a project or a production, they can go back to these people and email them or contact them, you know, send them a flyer in the mail back in the day and say, hey, we've got this new show. If you're interested, this is how you can book and come and see it. And I was looking at these incredibly talented artists on the stage who are, you know, putting their heart and soul into their art every night, but we just weren't thinking about this from a business point of view. And the more I thought about it, the more opportunity I felt like we were leaving on the table. Every performance, every week, we weren't doing something to build an audience that the artists could take with them to their next project. And so over the years, I've started coaching creatives in building their careers and working towards their creative goals. But I wanted to do this in a way that kind of helped more people than I could one-on-one. And so where you and I met, Gina, was kind of in the big ideas lab when I reached a point last year where I was like, I'm not playing much. I'm not in the theater. I've got time now to think about doing this in a more proactive way. What could I do? And so I worked on creating a workshop to share this idea with more creatives. The idea of what if you build an audience that you can take with you from project to project, an audience that you can build over time, you can nurture over time, so that you're not starting the whole marketing process from scratch every time you've got something to sell to people or you've got a project to share with people. I'll pass it back to you.
I love that so much. And this is something that I've been thinking a lot about over the past year and wishing that I knew about it sooner, wishing that I had started to build my community, you know, all the way back from high school even. And, you know, I think of all the people I've met in my life that had said, you know, please keep me posted on what you're doing. And yet, you know, how many of them did I actually keep posted, and how many,
exactly, right?
Right? Yeah.
How many of them slip through the cracks?
Yeah. And, you know, from the artist perspective, I think of my own cabaret shows and I think, well, yeah, but how do I capture that? Because the venue is the one selling the tickets. The venue is the one that's getting the email address. You know, I don't want to be standing on the stage and be like, join my email list, please. Right. So I think that there is a disconnect between how to make this all seamlessly work as an artist.
Yeah, I think that's true. But I think once we start thinking about this is what we might want to do, then we can start creating ways to do it. And I actually went to in Australia, we do have some shows have opened up again. And I went to see a concert a few weeks ago, and it was interesting. It was a classical music chamber concert. And at the end of the show, the lady that was performing, she actually stood up and said, if you've enjoyed the show, you can follow me on Instagram at this, my handle, and the other two people in my trio, these are their handles on Instagram. Please follow us. So people can get up at the end of the show and say, you know, follow me on social media or subscribe to my email list. And I think that certainly in a cabaret show, really, we need to look at how we can get access to that ticket buyer information, the email addresses and things like that, because you really should be entitled to it just as much as the cabaret room or the ticket seller. So I think that's something that we can consider. But it's also something we can encourage at every point of contact with the audience. So certainly we find ways to reach out to people in the first place to let them know about the show. It might be through our social media. And certainly social media is part of building an audience as well, but I think that the email list part of it is kind of like the heart of it, or the headquarters of your marketing center, which we sometimes ignore because it doesn't feel as sexy. It doesn't feel like it gets the instant gratification that if we can put up a great image or a great photo and get some likes from it, it feels like it's slower to build. But from what I've learned and from everything that I learned from business, that the conversion rate of email is still a lot stronger than it is from social media. But I think there's ways to do that. I think that we can use our websites more effectively to funnel people into our email lists. There's plenty of touch points along the way with our audience journey or our customer journey. A customer is how other businesses talk about it, but I feel a little bit hesitant to call them customers when it comes to creative arts and artists. But at each point along the journey, there are opportunities to say, hey, now that we've connected, why don't we, you know, make this official and join my email list?
That's great. You mentioned at the very beginning of your story about getting positive reinforcement back for your playing. And I'm thinking of a conversation I had with a friend the other day, and she was talking about all of the work she has put into her social media. And truly, she's an extraordinary content creator, and yet the followers were not coming. And I think that sometimes as artists, we can feel like we're putting out all this content and we're not getting the positive reinforcement back or the encouragement back that we would like to see. What are your thoughts on that? Do you have any advice or any tips?
Yeah, I've got lots of thoughts about it, Gina. I don't know that, you know, I mean, and if I share my thoughts, then you can translate them into advice and tips if you like. I think the first thing to think about is that none of us are likely to build an audience overnight, and that we're all inclined to want it to happen more quickly. No matter how quickly it happens, we want it to happen quicker. And so maybe it's just a matter of continuing to show up consistently and hoping that it will continue to build gradually. Lots of successful online content creators will talk. I was watching a video by a really successful guy on YouTube, and he was saying that for the first year, he produced content consistently throughout the year and really got a minimal amount of attention. But the second year, it started increasing, and by the third year of, like, he was creating one or two decent length YouTube videos a week. By the third year, that was when he started to get an uptick in people watching and subscribing to his channel. So I think it's a matter of playing the long game. It's a matter of being consistent with what you, who you want to, who you are, you know, this idea of being authentic, like staying true to who you are, but also paying attention to the audience. And if the audience, you know, responds certain ways to certain things, then maybe you can give them a bit more of that, or at least learn from that. I think sometimes I see people that are growing their social media accounts and their accounts seem to be growing and they seem to be getting a lot of likes and engagement. But I think then sometimes that encourages us to go for the lowest possible bar of, you know, ways to show up on social media. And ultimately, I don't think that gets people like you and your friend, the audience that you necessarily want. And so if you want a high quality audience, you've got to continue creating high quality content and just trust that the audience will learn about you and you'll learn about the audience over time. Just like any business, really, nothing's guaranteed. And there are people that are going to fall off along the way. I can't promise that anyone's going to be successful. And I definitely assure you that not everyone's going to be successful. But I think if we know why we're showing up and we are prepared to do it consistently over a good length of time, then we have more chance. And at least we can feel positive about what we're doing.
That's wonderful. So I'm curious, from your own experience, what have you seen or learned since you started doing this? You write constantly, you have your podcast, you are a master connector, just listening to people and having conversations. And so I'm wondering just what you've noticed from building your own audience.
That's a great question. I feel like I'm a naturally curious person. Like, I like to get to know people and learn about their stories. So what I do as a podcaster with my show Studio Time is I really get to enjoy doing that thing that comes naturally to me and that I love. Like, I like learning about people's stories. I like trying to understand them. And so when I realized that was a strength of mine, it was kind of like a superpower, then I tried to explore how could I use that in other aspects of my life. So with my particular blog or newsletter called The Infinite Creative, I bring that mindset to it. Like, I'm curious. These are the ideas that I'm thinking about and that, you know, were interesting enough to me to spend some time writing down, and I want to share them with you and see how they resonate with you. Maybe these are useful to you, or, you know, I don't get much of this on my site at the moment, but I would really welcome some useful feedback, some people sometimes pushing back on the ideas and saying, well, have you thought about it from this perspective? I want to try and create a conversation. I'm not necessarily trying to show up as the expert, but I want to show up as the guy who's curious and would love to gather a community of people to learn together. And I feel like this business our whole business, really, none of us are going to master it by ourselves. But if we gather together, if we band together, then we can learn together, learn from each other, support each other. And, you know, the idea of the rising tide lifts all ships. My Audience by Design workshop, which I created and which is going to start on March the 29th, is designed in that way. It's a cohort-based workshop, so that rather than me just sending out a bunch of lessons, people do it in their own time, they work on it in their own time. It's cohort based, so that we learn together. The people that are doing the course get together and they share their work so that they can encourage each other. They can give each other useful feedback. They can help hold each other accountable, because, you know, none of these ideas are radical. None of these ideas are not something that we haven't heard or thought about. But like you said, mostly they're ideas that we just haven't really bought into, we haven't committed to yet. And I think that one of the reasons is because committing to them is difficult. Marketing ourselves is difficult because there's just so much attached to it. You know, am I good enough? you know, when I ran the preview version of this workshop, you know, the question that came up often is, well, who's going to want to hear from me on a regular basis? But within that group we had, we discovered that, you know, everybody else in the group is fascinated by your story. They want to learn more. And so when you get just that little bit of encouragement and positive reinforcement, it gives you reason to show up and do the work consistently and keep doing it over the time so that, you know, you give it a chance to build.
Yes. So that's my other question about consistency. This takes a lot of time. And it's something that I definitely struggle with personally. I know things that I want to do. I know that I want to email my list more. I know that I want to post on social media more. I know that I want to, you know, do this and that as far as content. And I might even plan it out. Maybe I'll have a batch day where I plan I'm going to post this, 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 and this. And then I don't have time to do it. And so I'm wondering, I mean, you put out so much content. I'm wondering how you have found your rhythm or what advice you have for fitting it into already packed lives.
Yeah, that's another good question. I do publish quite a bit of content to the blog. I will, you know, number of times a week I'll show up there. But even then, I wish I was more consistent. If I could do it every day, then I'd be really reaching my goal. And I struggle with that as well. But I think, again, it's once we realize that it matters, that other people care about whether we show up or not, it makes it easier. As you were describing that, I was thinking to myself, you know, this is it seems like an archaic reference now because we don't, you know, especially in America, you know, not everybody is going out and socializing just yet. But, you know, when we used to meet friends for coffee, we would make time for that during the week. You know, you could be busy, but still I'd find half an hour to go and have coffee with a friend or whatever, because I knew that it was something I could do and I could open the loop and I could close the loop on that thing, because I knew there was a place to be. There was a reason to be there. There would be somebody else who'd care that I'd shown up for the coffee. And then I could go home and I'd be like, okay, that's done. On to the next thing. And so once you develop a relationship with the audience, this is another thing that I think is a big part of the philosophy or the strategy of audience by design, is developing a relationship with the audience, with your audience, that feels like it's two-way. So rather than me just blasting people with information about the show I've got coming up, it's about having a conversation about, this is the things that I'm thinking about, this is the work that I'm doing, this is why. And also like recognizing the stories that are happening within our audience, the stories that are happening in our community, so that it feels like it's a more of a back and forth, just like coffee. Like if me going to coffee was me getting a coffee and sitting in the front window of the coffee shop, hoping that some people would notice me as I walked by, then it wouldn't be the same thing as going to the coffee shop, meeting a friend there, sharing the coffee, having a conversation, and then going home.
I love that perspective. That's beautiful. And I also think sometimes like, okay, so I have my 30 minutes. I want to write something. What do I write about? Oh, no, I don't know that anybody wants to hear that. Do I even have an idea to write? Right? We can have all these self-doubt conversations in our own heads that prevent us from putting the thing out, putting a message out there. So yeah, how do you work with that?
Over time, I think we learn about what our audience wants to hear about. And so then that gives us the option, if we know that they're interested in whatever your particular story is, then you can keep coming back to that story. However, I don't think we necessarily know what's going to be the great post, the great, you know, whether it's in an email to your list, whether it's your post on Instagram, whether it's something to YouTube, or whether it's a show you created, it's hard to know how people are going to respond to it until you actually share it with them. And the other thing that I've discovered from my own personal experience, and tell me if you've had this as well, is that I don't need to get 100 likes or you know, a lot of email back every time I share something. But if I share it consistently, then every now and then someone will write back to me and say, hey, I really related to that. Or a friend will say to me, oh, I sort of discovered, I read that post of yours just when I needed to read it. And it hit me at just the right time. And I find that I get messages like that just often enough to reassure me that what I'm doing matters. And so I choose to keep showing up, knowing that, you know, maybe not everything I post is going to be a, you know, a home run, but it matters enough to keep doing it. I've got an example. A friend of mine, Adam, he had to give a eulogy at his brother's funeral a couple of months ago, which came suddenly, and that was unfortunate. But I spoke to him just afterwards, and he said, you know, I'd read a couple of your posts just before, as I was thinking about what I was going to say, and they were really helpful in me framing how I wanted to show up for this eulogy. Now, I wouldn't consider that I was writing posts to help people write eulogies, but by sharing what was important to me, it somehow connected with him. And I think that is wonderful. I mean, it wasn't my intention, but the fact that it happened was incredible. And it wouldn't have happened if I'd decided not to share that idea.
That's amazing. And I think it's so true. If we can share things from an aligned place within ourselves, the chances of it resonating with others are far greater.
Mm-hmm. There's a great blogger. His name is Gabe Anderson. He's got a blog called GabeTheBassPlayer.com. And he's got these really pithy posts. He's really good. He's like Seth Godin in that he can say a lot in a few words. But he talked about, sometimes people will say, oh, I don't really like the band, but I really loved their documentary. And there's something in that, that knowing the story and knowing what somebody or a band or an artistic group believes in and what they're working towards really helps us appreciate their art on a different plane. And I think as artists, sometimes we think, well, the art should speak for itself. I'll just create this. I'll put it out in the world and it will reach the audience it needs to. And it doesn't always happen that way. I mean, you think about Netflix. There's an infinite number of shows on Netflix. And so how do we know which ones to connect with? It could be that we've heard a friend tell us about it. It's been recommended. It might be that Netflix has a way that they've discovered that they can highlight it on their preview screen. But every time they're doing that, it's a very short story, but they're telling you a short story about what this show is. So they give you some context. They don't just wait for you to discover all the great shows they've got there. They find ways to tell you stories about it, how to bring them to your attention.
I've been thinking a lot about context recently, and what I have settled on is that all art has some form of context. It doesn't necessarily need a specific context to be appreciated, but I think that having a rich context is like an onion that you can peel back deeper layers and learn more about it and follow your curiosity rabbit holes. And I think that there is a huge missed opportunity there to share parts of our process, to share, you know, why we are choosing to perform certain material, to share about the composers and the writers. There's so much there that enriches the experience besides just the song or the show itself.
Yeah, I can quote myself here. I was thinking about this on The Infinite Creative a while back and thinking about context and stories. And I think that with anything we create, that there's going to be a story that the audience wraps your work in. And there's going to be a story that they tell themselves about it. And I think we have an option about whether we want to have a voice in that story or whether we want to leave it entirely up to them. And I think There are some artists. The first one that comes to mind for me is Bob Dylan. Bob Dylan doesn't talk about his work much. He just creates it. He puts it out there. He's kind of famously non-committal about the background, the context for his work. And I guess that's his thing. But it's, and it works for him. But there are probably a million or a billion artists who've done the same thing, just put their work out in the world with no context. And I couldn't tell you their names because I never saw their work.
Wow. So you kind of touched on this a bit, but I'm hoping you can elaborate. We talked about the audience portion of audience by design. I'm curious about the by design part, the strategic element, the what do you mean by design?
I guess it's twofold. The unspoken part of the title of the workshop is that we don't end up with an audience by accident. So if we want an audience, it needs to be by design. And I didn't study design at university. I studied jazz piano. So that qualifies me for basically nothing. But I've learned about design thinking over the years. And the idea about design thinking is being really intentional about, you know, the questions, who's it for, what's it for, and really thinking about what you're trying to create and why. And so this is part of the design part of it. It's about coming up with a strategy that makes sense to you as the artist. This is why I want to show up. This is what I'm showing up for, which gives you a reason to show up consistently because it matters to you. And as it matters to you, and as we start sharing what matters to us, other people respond to that. And they're able to, if it connects with them, if it's something that matters to them as well, they see that and they get on board. It's like any sort of community, I think. I think it's like that for people that go to church. I think it's like that for people that are really into their sports club, you know. And there are things, I mean, a sports club is a, I'm not a sports guy either. I'm a jazz piano player. But, you know, people that get together at sports games, whether it's to see the football or here it's the cricket sometimes or whatever your sport is, people come from so many disparate backgrounds, but they don't need to have everything in common. But at the game, they just need to have one thing in common, their love for the game and their love for their team. And they show up for the game and they show up for the team. And, you know, unless you're an English soccer fan, you know, everyone gets on okay. And because they're there for the reason, and they realize, oh, we're all here together for this particular reason. And I think we see that, you know, we see that in some of the rallies, you know, I don't necessarily want to say protests, but the rallies we've seen over the past year where people get together for things that they believe in that really matter to them, whether it's a Black Lives Matters rally or in Australia on just in the last couple of days, we've had women getting together again to stand up for women's rights and, you know, us acknowledging women's voices, which I think is really important. And I think that, you know, here we see that women are going to have to keep showing up and up because us men are slow to listen apparently. But, you know, they do keep showing up because it's that important to them, right? Like you could, you know, I guess we go through phases, but maybe you think, well, no one's listening, so maybe I'll just give up. But when it's that important to you and you see that it becomes that important to other people as well, that gives us a reason to continue showing up. So that's a little bit about the design.
I have chills because I just got a perspective shift hearing you speak, and that is this idea of having one thing in common, and that is our common humanity, right? There's something that binds us together, and as an artist, it kind of blew my mind to think that we could be that common denominator, that our work could be that. And, you know, I think on one perspective, that can be a little bit like, you know, oh, it's us that's like egotistical. But hearing you speak of using that platform for purpose and, you know, the things that you believe in, the things that matter to you, the things that are important to you are also probably of interest to your audience. So that idea of using your platform to bring people together and to just point out our common humanity, I think is very, very beautiful.
Yeah, I mentioned it earlier on, and I have to give a lot of credit to this author, Kevin Kelly, who wrote the article, 1,000 True Fans, because he really sparked this idea for me. And Kevin was kind of like an early exponent of the internet and sort of understanding how the internet could change things. And he realized that because we're all connected via the internet, that once upon a time, if I was the guy that really liked, I don't know, green tree frogs, me finding a community of green tree frog aficionados was perhaps going to be hard in my neighborhood or in my village once upon a time, right? But via the power of the internet, all the people that love and are fascinated by green tree frogs are able to find each other because we all start searching for the same thing. One person starts a green tree frog blog and all the other people gradually start to find it. So there's this idea that, you know, we can, by showing up and really digging into this thing that makes us interesting, our own brand of weird maybe, is really powerful on the internet because you're able to find and connect with other people that share that same brand of weird. And then to sort of follow up what Kevin said about 1,000 True Fans is that if we find people that are really invested in what we need to do, we don't need to have an audience of a million followers to make a living as an artist or a creative. He demonstrated that if you could find 1,000 people who were willing to support you, what he called your true fans, they would show up and they would come to every show you did, or, you know, they would contribute to your Patreon account if that's what you did, or whatever. If 1,000 people were willing to commit $100 a year to the work you do, then you can make a living as an artist. You don't need a million people. You just need a 1,000 people who are willing to spend $100 a year on what you do. And $100 is not that outrageous. You and I have things we spend $100 on without really thinking about it too much, and plenty of things we spend money on regularly. And that because if it's something we believe in, if it's something that reinforces our identity, our values, then it's where we put our attention, it's where we put our money. And so this is not, I don't think it's a selfish approach. I think it's a generous approach.
Wow. I've heard the concept of 1,000 true fans, but I've never heard a dollar amount attached to it before. And hearing that $100 really, I guess, brought it to reality for mm-hmm. me.
Yeah. I mean, Kevin breaks it down more. He says, I mean, sure, if you've got 2,000 true fans, then it's $50. And also, it's not like, how can I extract $100 from all those people? It's what can I create that is of value? I mean, and Seth Godin will talk about this with his marketing. How can I create something that's worth well more than $100 so that people, it will be a bargain for somebody to give me $100 so that they get that product or that feeling of association or being part of something. And this idea of being part of something that's a bit bigger than just us individually, I think is something that we all look for. I think it's something that we've been, you know, certainly finding new ways to find over the past 12 months when we haven't been connecting in the way we used to connect. I think there are heaps of opportunities. And when we start breaking it down, you can start thinking about tangible ways you can create value. You can think about, the other thing is, it's not inconceivable to build an audience of 1,000 people. If you think, you know, and this is where the better conversion rate helps as well. If you can convert, if people pay more attention, or you can connect better with people on email than you can on social media, this makes a difference as well. But, you know, people think of 1,000 followers on Instagram as nothing these days. You know, you've got to have 100,000 or a million. And if you feel like you need to have a million followers on Instagram, then it suggests that what you're creating is really of very little value, right? So why don't I work on creating more value for a smaller number of people than creating basically no value for an infinite number of people?
Wow. That's a wake-up call. Yes. So where do you suggest that people start? If artists are listening to this and they maybe don't have an email list or a very, very small one, maybe, you know, aren't so thrilled with their social media numbers, they think, what do I post about? Just how do people get started building their audience by design?
What we learned when we ran through the first version of this workshop, that was actually even a bigger factor than I realized when I created the workshop, was getting clear about your story is really useful. And so having a much more focused story than the one I started this episode with is useful, because you don't always have 12 minutes to like get people's attention. But what we looked at in the workshop is where you've come from, where you are now, and how that influences where you plan to go next, where you're headed. And so it gives a bit of context. We go back to the word context. To anyone who wants to pay attention to what you're doing, this is the past is kind of how and why you got to where you are now. That's the context for now. And then that all provides the context for where you're going in the future. And I think something else I've been thinking about just in the last couple of weeks, we get quite practiced at telling the story of how we got from the beginning to this point in time. And that's useful. I mean, that's what we use in our bios and in our about pages and stuff like that. But telling a story about the past is interesting to a point. But I think the idea of your quest from where you are now to where you're headed, I think that's actually a much more compelling story, because people, if they believe or want to see whether you get to that endpoint, then they're compelled to follow your story.
The story of your quest.
Mm-hmm.
I love that.
Getting back to like really tactical, once you understand that, then you can start communicating it. You can start communicating it, and that becomes then kind of your elevator pitch to new people that come into your universe. If you want to be able to connect with them pretty quickly, because you only have a little bit of attention before somebody is going to get, especially on Instagram, before they're going to get distracted by the next post, right? That's another reason why email is useful, because on social media, you're just part of the infinite scroll. There's always something above your post, below your post, to the left and to the right of it. And so you're fighting, I think you call it fighting for attention. Whereas email, certainly we all have probably more emails in our inbox than we can really cope with each day. But I think when somebody clicks open an email, we're making a micro commitment to discovering what's inside there. And once you're in an email, you're not quite as distracted by the posts on either side. You're kind of in it for a second. So I think that's one of the reasons why I really like email.
That's great. So I'm curious, obviously you're very passionate about artists building their own audiences, but for Matthew Carey's quest, for your vision of the future, what do you see for yourself as an artist, for your fellow artists, for the arts industry?
I was working on a musical tour when COVID hit, you know, last year. And it gave me a chance, it forced me to rethink what I was doing. The tour ended, you know, just like anybody else in our industry. We did our final show, we came into work the next day, we realized that we'd done our final show without necessarily realizing it had been the final one. And I'd been doing that consistently for 5 years, which was great. I really loved the work, but I'd become a little bit complacent. And I was kind of just riding along this journey, which was comfortable, and it had stopped me from taking the initiative to do more of this work about helping other artists. And I feel like I've spent a lot of time building my own career and helping artists make better work. And right now, what I'm interested in is helping artists make better careers. So we talked about, you know, how money is sometimes crass. And I feel like some sort of, I feel a bit of discomfort talking about it sometimes, but we need money to live. We need money to survive. I mean, anybody else goes to work, they go to work to earn money, right? But none of us got into this business to make a fortune, except for maybe Michael Feinstein. You know, if we wanted to be millionaires, we probably would have chosen a different path. But we need resources to make our career sustainable. So that is kind of my overall focus, is how can I help the artists that I care about build careers that sustain them creatively, emotionally, and financially, so that you can get up tomorrow and continue to do the work that matters to you. And so right now I can play piano at home. I don't feel like I need to be in the theater to do that. And what I'm excited about is sharing this idea with more and more people, so that I can, I mean, I've lived the starving artist story. I mean, we call it a starving artist myth, but it's not a myth when you're in the middle of it. It's actually a reality, but it doesn't need to be. And I think if we can sort of bust that and help artists see, oh, well, there's actually a path that I can build a sustainable career, then I think that's worthwhile. That feels worthwhile to me.
I love that, and I thank you for that. Are there any other practices in your daily life that are helping you along this journey?
I want to become a better writer. And one of my steps to doing that is doing morning pages. You've probably had people talk about morning pages before. I think everybody kind of finds their own way. My practice of that is that if I don't do morning pages, pretty much the first thing when I wake up, the rest of the day gets in the way. And so I like to do that. Julia Cameron, who coined the idea, suggests you just freehand 3 pages of writing each morning. I've got really small handwriting, and I find that 3 pages would like take me an hour and a half. So I do 30 minutes, like a minimum of 30 minutes of morning pages in the morning. And that can sometimes be creative writing. Sometimes it is just musing on what happened the day before or what I have to do today. But something about that helps unlock me in the beginning of the day and start getting my creative juices going. And I guess it starts making me aware of the world around me. And I think then the rest of this has just sort of blossomed from there. It's once you start observing what's going on and being willing to try, and for me, it's write it down. I mean, for us as artists, it's taking what we see in the world around us and finding a way to synthesize it into our particular discipline, right? Like for you as a vocalist, you find, you know, what inspires you in the world around you, and then you transmit that through your voice. For me, it's either on the piano keys or it's in writing, whether it's by hand or typing on the computer. Other people dance, other people put it into their character on stage, or into their jokes if you're a comedian. And so that I found is really helpful. I know the other thing, I mean, the one thing about making morning pages my first thing in the day is that it gets me sitting down inside. And so the other thing that I really like to do during the day, it just helps with my general emotional well-being, but I think it helps with my creativity as well, is making sure I get outdoors and moving sometime during the day. If I've ended up within these four walls for more than 48 hours, they go a little bit crazy. So I just really try and make a point of getting outside each day and just interacting with the world around me. And I know that, you know, we have to do that carefully sometimes at this point, you know, whether it's with a mask or, you know, staying out in the open, but I find that's really important.
That's great. So we have 2 parlor games. The first is called Lighting the Candle. What person, resource, organization, idea would you like to pass the torch to and illuminate?
I gave this some thought. Something that I I discovered yesterday, actually, Gina, is that Disney's releasing a new film called, I think it's called Raya and the Last Dragon. And it's Disney's first Southeast Asian princess. And as soon as I heard about this, I thought about my friend and probably yours, Priya Mahendra.
Yes.
Priya, over the past 12 months, created this Princess Possibility Project, where she, as who identifies as a South Asian artist, she put her spin on the on like lots of the different Disney princesses and their classic songs. And so when I saw this, I reached out to Priya and I said, I don't know whether you influenced Disney in making this happen, but Disney must have seen what people like Priya were doing, and they realized that this was important. And even if no one specifically at Disney saw what Priya was doing, I saw what Priya was doing. I saw the videos that she recorded, and she helped me see how important that Raya and the Last Dragon is. And I think that was a real gift that she gave to me in this past 12 months. And so if anyone listening or watching hasn't discovered Priya Mahendra's Princess Possibility Project, I'd love for you to see that.
Oh, I'm tearing up. It is such a beautiful project. And thank you for bringing that to everyone's attention. So our last question is called The Parrot. If we were all your parrots, what would you teach us to say?
Right now it'd be, you're not going to build an audience by accident.
You're not going to build an audience by accident. Matthew Carey, thank you so much. Where can people learn more about Audience by Design? Is there anything else you want them to know about the program?
Sure. Right now, we're in March. The program next session begins on March the 29th. People can find out directly about that program at audiencebydesign.com. And then the rest of my writing is at theinfinitecreative.com.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for being here. Thank you for sharing your knowledge, your wisdom, your insight. But most importantly, you are one of the most generous creatives I know. You truly just reach out and wrap everybody in your arms and encourage everybody. So thank you so much for all of the work that you do to inspire others.
It's really my pleasure. I'm really glad to be able to be here talking to you, Gina, because I think the work that you're doing is incredible, elevating artists and ideas. And I think that's really important. I woke up early so that I could speak to you. So I haven't done my morning pages, but it's almost 6 a.m. So I'm going to get to that next.
I didn't realize it was that early. I'm terrible with time changes.
This is the perfect time to be speaking.
Oh, well, thank you so much, Matthew Carey, all the way from Australia. Have a beautiful day, everyone.
Bye.